Korea to Vietnam. We present three documentaries on problems of American foreign policy. They were originally broadcast in the BBC's third program, where they formed part of a survey by D.G. Bridson of America since the bomb. Bomb Diplomacy is the title of the first of these documentaries. It looks at America's position in the world after the making of the atomic bomb in 1945.
That music was being played over the radio when the program was interrupted for a special announcement.
Scientists, British and American, have made the atomic bomb at last. The first one was dropped on a Japanese city this morning. It was designed for a detonation equal to 20,000 tons of high explosives.
In America, the official communique from the White House ended with this statement from President Truman.
I shall recommend that the Congress of the United States consider promptly the establishment of an appropriate commission to control the production and use of atomic power within the United States. I shall give further consideration and make further recommendations to the Congress as to how atomic power can become a powerful and forceful influence toward the maintenance of world peace. We return you now to the Fred Waring program.
So, America and the world at large entered the nuclear age. War has always been war, and the purpose of war is to kill the enemy. Whether this is done with one bomb, as at Hiroshima and Nagasaki, or by many dropped simultaneously, as at Hamburg and Dresden, is perhaps an academic question. But the problems created by the atomic bomb were new to warfare. They were referred to by one of its architects, Dr. Albert Einstein.
You all know that the development of this frightful mean of destruction was urgently demanded by the perils of the wartime situation. Simultaneously, however, a new perilous situation has been created whose shadow is upon us continually. One cannot defend oneself effectively anymore.
One cannot defend oneself effectively anymore. It was the realization of that fact slowly arrived at which has overshadowed life in the post-war world, not least of all for the Americans.
I suppose that history will remember my term in office as the years when the Cold War began to overshadow our lives. I have had hardly a day in office that has not been dominated by this all-embracing struggle, this conflict between those who love freedom and those who would lead the world back into slavery and darkness. And always in the background, there has been the atomic bomb.
Whatever it was for President Truman, for most Americans in 1945, the bomb was not particularly menacing. The bomb was an American monopoly, and there seemed no valid reason to have to use it again. The bomb was a deterrent to war rather than a danger, an insurance policy taken out in the cause of peace. In some ways, it provided an exciting spectacle, as at Bikini, where two atomic bombs were tested in 1946, the second underwater.
Firing time, and I have just been interrupted.
30 seconds.
That's the voice of the control strip marking the seconds remaining. The final switches have been thrown. No one can stop it. The atomic bomb is about to explode.
Firing time.
How it will sound,
20 seconds.
We do not know how it's going to sound, but 42,000 men here are watching, tensely awaiting that explosion.
Firing time.
All of the observer ships.
10 seconds.
All of the observer ships are in position in the open sea. We're about 10 miles away. I
5
think
seconds.
Target.
4, 3, 2, 1.
More of a volcanic eruption than an explosion. And it's remarkable that the sole surviving memory of the bikini test is the name of a popular swimsuit.
An atom bomb heart you're carrying around with just one ambition to conquer men of the town. The ones that you fold all carry the mark from the dangerous love lies in your atom bomb.
By 1946, in fact, the bomb appeared to have been well and truly assimilated into the American way of life. But had it?
Why hold the test now? There are many reasons why these tests should be held now and not in the distant, uncertain future. Many lessons were learned from the war just won. We learned of the tragedy, the sorrow, the great cost of war. All thinking men and women learned that the moral nations must forever remain so strong that another war would be impossible. The safety of this nation in an atomic age cannot be built on good intentions and the decision to prepare when the time comes. Our safety must depend on the mutual respect of all nations, on the understanding of other nations that while we are strong and well prepared, we do not want to fight, on the knowledge that we will use our strength only to control any world gangsters who may threaten world peace.
So said General Eisenhower in explanation of the Bikini test. Not only had the test furnished vital information on the potential of the bomb, it had also served as a reminder that the bomb could be used against an aggressor. As President Truman had said, possession of the bomb was a grave responsibility for any nation to bear alone. For behind the bomb lay the promise of atomic power, and there lay hope for all mankind. Could the secrets of atomic energy be shared with the world without endangering American security? America hoped that they could. Said Bernard Baruch,
"My fellow members of the United Nations Atomic Energy Commission and my fellow citizens of the world, we are here to make a choice between the quick and the dead. That is our business. Behind the black portent of the new atomic age lies a hope which, seized upon with faith, can work our salvation. If we fail, then we have damned every man to be the slave of fear. Let us not deceive ourselves. We must elect world peace or world destruction."
Unhappily, that question is still at issue. The proposal to share atomic secrets in return for a worldwide system of free inspection of all atomic plants was not acceptable to the Soviet Union. Their counterproposal that instead all atomic weapons should immediately be destroyed, understandably enough, proved unacceptable to the Americans. The rift between Soviet policy and that of the Western powers had been obvious even in the days of the Grand Alliance, nor had it wholly been glossed over at Yalta, despite President Roosevelt's optimism.
"We argued freely and frankly across the table, but at the end, on every point, unanimous agreement was reached. And more important even than the agreement of words, I may say we achieved a unity of thought and a way of getting along together."
Alas for that hope. The actions of the Soviet Union in Eastern Europe, both before and after the end of the war in Europe, had done more than enough to destroy the West's belief in Stalin's good intentions. As Winston Churchill put it in his famous speech at Fulton, Missouri in 1946,
"From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe. Warsaw, Berlin, Prague, Vienna, Budapest, Belgrade, Bucharest, and Sofia. All these famous cities and the populations around them lie in what I must call the Soviet sphere. And all our subjects, in one form or another, not only to Soviet influence, but to a very high and in some cases increasing measure of control from Moscow."
Churchill's Fulton speech chimed with the sentiments of most Americans, including President Truman, in whose presence it was delivered. World War II had already been succeeded by the Cold War, and to that, America was soon to be committed. As Churchill had reminded Americans, most of Eastern Europe had already fallen into the Russian sphere of influence, with all that it implied. Only prompt action by Britain had prevented Greece being swallowed up equally. And in 1947, due to the economic crisis, Britain was forced to serve notice that she could no longer support the Greek regime. President Truman's reaction was immediate and decisive. In a speech to Congress on March 12, 1947, he virtually changed the course of American history.
The United States has received from the Greek government an urgent appeal for financial and economic assistance. Preliminary reports from the American Economic Mission, now in Greece, and reports from the American ambassador in Greece corroborate the statement of the Greek government that assistance is imperative if Greece is to survive as a free nation. I do not believe that the American people and the Congress wish to turn a deaf ear to the appeal of the Greek government.
Aid to Greece, however, was not the only proposal.
Turkey also deserves our attention. The circumstances in which Turkey finds itself today are considerably different from those of Greece. Turkey has been spared the disasters that have beset Greece. And during the war, the United States and Great Britain furnished Turkey with material aid.
President Truman then went on to the reasons for such aid.
Should we fail to aid Greece and Turkey in this fateful hour, the effect will be far-reaching to the West as well as to the East. We must take immediate and resolute action. I therefore ask the Congress to provide authority for assistance to Greece and Turkey in the amount of $400 million for the period ending June 30th, 1948.
The course demanded by President Truman involved one other factor, quite apart from the provision of economic assistance.
In addition to funds, I ask the Congress to authorize the detail of American civilian and military personnel to Greece and Turkey at the request of those countries to assist in the tasks of reconstruction and for the purpose of supervising the use of such financial and material assistance as may be furnished. I recommend that authority also be provided for the instruction and training of selected Greek and Turkish personnel.
The principles inherent in that remarkable speech became known as the Truman Doctrine. And to appreciate their full significance, it's necessary to remind ourselves of the previous blueprint of American international policy, the Monroe Doctrine. For it's been suggested that the two doctrines are contradictory. But are they? The Monroe Doctrine, propounded by President Monroe in 1823, not merely warned off any encroachment of European power in the American hemisphere. That clause was to be invoked over Russian rockets in Cuba. The Monroe Doctrine states,
"Our policy in regard to Europe, which was adopted at an early stage of the wars which have so long agitated that quarter of the globe, remained the same, which is, not to interfere in the internal concerns of any of its powers, to consider the government de facto as the legitimate government for us."
It was here, in fact, that the Truman Doctrine appeared to mark a departure from the spirit of the Monroe Doctrine. For the Truman Doctrine demanded intervention, including dispatch of military personnel, in order to prevent any communist takeover in Greece or Turkey. In other words, it drew a distinction between de jure government and what, without intervention, might emerge as de facto government. The reason adduced for this reversal of traditional American policy was obviously national security, which was held to be threatened by a communist-dominated Europe. The apparent reversal was already provided for by the Monroe Doctrine itself.
"To this we have adhered and shall continue to adhere, provided no change shall occur which, in the judgment of the competent authorities of this government, shall make a corresponding change on the part of the United States indispensable to their security."
There was the crux of the matter. Had the occurrence of the bomb marked such a change? In the opinion of President Truman, it had, despite the fact that the bomb remained, for the time being, in America's hands alone. After all, neither the bomb nor the ICBM had been in Washington's mind when he warned his country against foreign entanglements. But once the bomb had committed America to involvement, she carried her policy of foreign aid to its logical conclusion, that such aid should not be confined to Greece and Turkey.
It is logical that the United States should do whatever it is able to do to assist in the return of normal economic health in the world, without which there can be no political stability and no assured peace. Our policy is directed not against any country or doctrine, but against hunger, poverty, desperation, and chaos. Its purpose should be the revival of a working economy in the world, so as to permit the emergence of political and social conditions in which free institutions can exist.
With these words, in June 1947, General George C. Marshall launched America's full policy of economic aid to all countries which had suffered disruption of their economies as the result of World War II. For all such, hunger, poverty, desperation, and chaos, as he referred to, chaos in particular was held to be an open invitation to communist agitation and intervention. Perhaps it was understandable for that very reason that the Eastern Bloc refused to have any part of Marshall aid, which they denounced as virtual American intervention, on which point General Marshall commented,
"Any government that is willing to assist in the task of recovery will find full cooperation, I am sure, on the part of the United States government. Any government which maneuvers to block the recovery of other countries cannot expect help from us. Furthermore, governments, political parties, or groups which seek to perpetuate human misery in order to profit therefrom politically or otherwise will encounter the opposition of the United States."
Acceptance by the Western democracies of Marshall Aid, the European Recovery Program, as it was actually called, was grateful and enthusiastic. Over the next 4 years, some $12 billion were allocated to the program by Congress, and the results were soon to become apparent throughout Western Europe. The three military zones of Western Germany, American, British, and French, had already been merged, and Western German economy was quickly on the road to recovery. So much so that the Soviet Union began to express serious concern for her own security. Holding very different aims for the future of Germany, she could interrupt the process only in one way, short of actual hostilities, by attempting to drive the Western powers at least out of Berlin. By June the 25th, 1948, the Soviet blockade of the city was complete and the Berlin airlift was underway. The blockade lasted 321 days, in the course of which 272,000 Anglo-American flights, with French and German assistance, unloaded some 2.25 million tons of food and coal in the beleaguered city. Said General Lucius Clay of the operation at the time,
"The airlift to Berlin is the reply of the free people of the United States, the United Kingdom, and France to the attempt to use the starvation of more than 2 million people as a means for political coercion."
Said Dr. Friedensberg, the acting mayor of Berlin,
"I can only say that the people in Berlin are very grateful to the Anglo-American help through the air. And I can say for myself that with one ear I'm always outside listening whether the planes are coming and going. And it's the most terrible thing for me if everything is silent. Perhaps this gives you the best idea how we are feeling about the airlift."
Whatever else it achieved, the Berlin airlift broke down, perhaps more quickly than anything else could have done, any lingering distrust between Germany and America. The airlift had thrown them all together, Germans, French, Americans, and British, in a common effort to defeat the Soviet pressure. As General Clay declared when the airlift finally ended,
"Today, Berlin is no longer under blockade.
Heute unterliegt Berlin nicht mehr der Blockade.
I don't think that just means that trains and trucks are running again.
Ich glaube, das bedeutet nicht nur, dass wiederum die Züge und die Fahrzeuge rollen.
I think it has a much deeper significance.
Ich glaube, es hat eine viel tiefere Bedeutung.
I think it means that the people of Berlin have earned their right to freedom, to be accepted by those who love freedom everywhere.
Within a fortnight, the Federal Republic of Germany had been proclaimed with the blessing of France, Britain, and America. Not, of course, for the blessing of the Soviet Union, whose plans for German reunification amounted to the creation of another Soviet satellite state. The sponsoring, some 4 months later, of the German Democratic Republic, Eastern Germany, was the nearest that she could get to that. But even while the airlift was still in progress, America had negotiated a most important treaty, and so far, initiative in the Cold War had lain very largely with her. After the initial takeover bids in Eastern Europe, only Czechoslovakia had been lost to the West in 1948. Elsewhere, the communist policy of infiltration had been countered by the American policy of containment. And the clinching factor in that policy was the formation of NATO. The North Atlantic Treaty was signed by the United States, Canada, and 10 European countries on April the 4th, 1949.
There are those who claim that this treaty is an aggressive act on the part of the nations which ring the North Atlantic. That is absolutely untrue. The pact will be a positive, not a negative influence for peace. And its influence will be felt not only in the area it specifically covers, but throughout the world. In taking steps to prevent aggression against our own peoples, we have no purpose of aggression against other peoples. To suggest the contrary is to slander our institutions and defame our ideals and our aspirations. What we're about to do here is a neighborly act. We're like a group of householders living in the same locality who decide to express their community interests by entering into a formal association for their mutual self-protection.
Churchill's Fulton speech had certainly influenced America's international thinking in the later 40s. Another passage in the speech had given them food for thought at home.
In a great number of countries, far from the Russian frontiers, and throughout the world, communist fifth columns are established and work in complete unity and absolute obedience to the directions they receive from the communist center.
While the secrets of the atomic bomb remained with America, it was only natural that the communists should seek to get at them. The existence of the atomic bomb had been leaked to Moscow before it was ever used. In 1946, a Russian spy ring had been discovered in Canada. And in 1948, Alger Hiss had been denounced for passing State Department documents to Russia. All in all, it was not surprising that security should have become a matter of national concern. President Truman himself had called in the FBI to handle security checks in government services in 1947. For this, he was roundly assailed by ex-Vice President Henry Wallace.
I am committed to stopping the creation of fear, to using all my powers to prevent the fear makers from clogging the minds of the people with the red issue. Millions know, and millions more must see, that it is not the Kremlin, not the communists who have sent milk to 24 cents a quart and meat to $1.30 a pound, that it is the red issue and not the Reds who did this to us.
It was probably because he was supported by the Communist Party that Henry Wallace failed to carry a single state when he stood as Progressive Party candidate for the presidency the following year. Truman was re-elected on his record, of which security checking was a part. But the FBI was not alone in its search for communist agents. Unmasking of communists at large had already been avidly taken up by the House Committee on Un-American Activities. And with an eye on the headlines, their happiest hunting ground, inevitably, had been Hollywood.
Are you a member of the Communist Party? Or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
It's unfortunate and tragic that I have to teach this committee the
that's
basic principles of America.
That's not the question. The question is, have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
I'm framing my answer in the only way in which any American citizen can frame his
then
answer
you denied,
to the question
then you,
which invades his absolutely invasion.
Then you deny, you refuse to answer that question. Is that correct?
I told you that I will offer my beliefs, my affiliations, and everything else to the American public, and they will know where I stand, as they do from what I have witnessed.
Stand away from the stand.
I have been for Americanism for many years, and I
stand away from the stand.
Fight for the Bill of Rights, which you have done with this man away from the stand.
Interrogation of one of the Hollywood Ten. The witch hunt did not provide the happiest examples of American democracy at work. Many security risks were uncovered and wisely removed from access to secret information, but many innocent people were stigmatized quite recklessly and persecuted without any cause. David Lilienthal, whose appointment to the chairmanship of the Atomic Energy Committee had been quite unjustly assailed, had this to say for the record.
I deeply believe in the capacity of democracy to surmount any trials that may lie ahead, provided only that we practice it in our daily lives. And among the things we must practice is this, that while we seek fervently to ferret out the subversive and anti-democratic forces in the country, we do not at the same time, by hysteria, by resort to innuendo and smears and other unfortunate tactics, besmirch the very cause that we believe in.
In January 1949, 11 leaders of the American Communist Party were put on trial. The charge? Conspiring to overthrow the United States government by force, an indictable offense under the Smith Registration Act. They were found guilty and later imprisoned. In March 1949, an honors graduate at Barnard College, Judith Copeland, was put on trial for espionage along with a Russian engineer from UNO. And as if to emphasize the growing communist menace, the Chinese People's Republic was proclaimed in September, marking the final triumph of Mao Zedong. America received the news with dismay, for it followed hard upon other news, the news that all Americans had hoped they would never hear.
President Truman has just announced to the nation and the world that, quoting him, we have evidence that within recent weeks, an atomic explosion occurred in the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. The news has just been confirmed by the British government.
So, the atomic bomb was no longer an American monopoly, as all America had known it never could be indefinitely. But the news had come much earlier than had been expected. Why? Had the secret of the bomb, in fact, been given away? The very month it was being exploded by the Russians in Siberia, a British MP had chided the Americans for failing to share the secret even with Britain.
We cannot forget that British scientists made most valuable contributions to the early discovery of atomic secrets. Without them, your progress could not have been so rapid. Therefore, we feel there should still be the fullest exchange of information. In any case, why should you not share your secrets? What are you afraid of? That we shall, through carelessness, let the Russians have them? There is little to fear on that account, for the communists are less powerful over here than they are with you. I doubt if there are as many fifth columnists in our civil service as recent investigations suggest you have in America. Therefore, there is no danger of a leak over here.